Great, thank you. I'm Eva Harris, and I'm in the Division of Infectious Diseases and Vaccinology, and it's really a great pleasure to be here today and contribute to this really interesting set of images as we move through the different aspects of our School of Public Health on its 75th birthday. So I'm going to tell you about what I work on, which is mosquito-borne viral diseases, and I'm going to start with my approach to dengue. So dengue is a major public health problem worldwide, and it's caused, it's a small RNA virus that has four flavors called 1 to 4, and it's transmitted by this mosquito called Aedes aegypti albopictus, and it's essentially the problem with this mosquito is that it breathes in clean water around people's homes, and so it's really well matched to the essentially the human ecology of the 21st century, and that's why we have huge problems that you've heard not only of dengue, but Zika, chikungunya, yellow fever, and others. And so the problem is that we have this uncontrolled spread. Well, there's half the world's population is at risk. We have about 100 million cases, and some of these more severe cases in healthy people can kill you in 24 to 48 hours, and so it's a really big kind of scientific and public health question at once. And so it's uncontrolled spread, and the numbers of cases, this is the number of countries and the cases, and also geographic spread. As you can see, this is hemorrhagic fever in the Americas over the past 20 or so years. But the way that we, when I first started working on this around 25 years ago, there were so many questions that I couldn't make up my mind. And so we kind of started this approach that was a much more kind of holistic approach than a lot of people take in different silos around infectious diseases, which is to work on a protein or to work on one aspect or work on the control. And what we tried to do in my program, in our program, is to really go across and have this kind of vision of the disease as an entirety. And so we work on molecular virology, so how does it replicate, how can we look for antiviral targets, how do we understand the host immune response, which is really important for dengue because, strangely, your immune response can be good, but it can actually be bad and can make it worse in the next. We need to understand what's good and what's bad about that response. We call that pathogenesis research as well. We need to know how to be able to diagnose it, to tell if it's there. How can we look at the study of epidemiology, which is of that disease in a population, and how do we really look at control? And then another part is this nonprofit that I direct together with Josefina Coloma here in the audience, which is really about building scientific capacity worldwide to address local problems. And so this whole program has been possible only because of this long collaboration over the past 30 years with our work in Nicaragua, where we have hospital studies, community-based studies, and then out to actually random controlled trials using exactly that CBPR, that community-based participatory research approach, to be able to control the mosquito vector, and based on long-term collaborations with the Ministry of Health. Now, so that was all in place when Zika hit. And Zika is a very close relative. And you can tell it's a close relative, which is called, this is called a phylogenetic tree. And it just lines up the differences in the nucleic acids or in the protein. And you can see that when this branch is very close, these are closely related. And of yellow fever, West Nile, et cetera, the ones that are most closely related to these four dengues is Zika. And that's a problem because then your immune response gets confused. And it gets cross-reactive between these different viruses. And then we can't tell anymore what's dengue and what's Zika. And so that causes a big problem at the level of, you know, many different levels, actually. But the thing is that Zika also looks kind of like dengue, only it's very mild, except when it's not. And when it's not is when a pregnant woman gets infected. And we never thought this. We either have neurotropic or encephalitic flaviviruses like West Nile, or we have systemic flaviviruses like dengue and yellow fever. But now suddenly we have this other one, which is causing this terrible microcephaly congenital Zika syndrome in pregnant women when they're infected. And that took everybody by surprise. And it also hit Latin America really, really strongly because there was no immunity in the entire population. So what I'm going to show you next is in Nicaragua. This is essentially one of our studies, which is based in the District 2 of Managua, which is the capital of Nicaragua. And what you're going to see is every child, which is 3,700 children who have been in our study almost up to 15 years, and their homes are geo-positioned, so they're geo-referenced. And what you're going to see are, in yellow, the number of cases over time. And so what we see is it started in January, but then we had two dry months where there's no mosquitoes. And then it started again in June, it started picking up. And then we had July, August, September, done. 2.5 months, essentially. And so what happened was that what I called, there wasn't actually one question that came out of all this. There was what I called a zillion Zika questions. And so one of them is, so how is this virus getting into the placenta? Like, viruses are not supposed to go to the placenta. There's supposed to be ways to stop it. Why is Zika making it? how do we even detect the virus? How do we know that the virus is Zika and not dengue or chikungunya? How do we detect, once the virus has passed, what people hadn't had, which is the mark on their immune system by antibodies, when all the antibodies are all confused among themselves? So, and then how do we learn that, take that information, and understand what happened in the epidemiology of that epidemic in not just one country, but all over Latin America and all over the world? How do we know whether dengue, which is very closely related, is protective, or whether it's pathogenic, or whether it's nothing? And then finally, how do we control the mosquito that's actually driving all of this to begin with? And so what we did is we just took that same approach back to this vision of kind of the bench to the field. And so we were able to, in Nicaragua, very quickly add Zika to all of our existing studies. But then we also started new studies of household transmission and also three new studies of Zika in pregnant women, which we'd actually never worked in that population before, but we learned very quickly. And so we were able to address a whole bunch of questions that were very relevant, and then take that one step back to this whole program. And when I say this program, it's really looking at, you know, what we can understand in the lab, and then bringing that to observationally into human populations, but also observing in human populations and bringing that back to the lab. And since we've been training people back and forth over so many years, this includes Berkeley students going to Nicaragua, Nicaraguans coming to Berkeley, and then essentially establishing an overall level of scientific capacity that can address this across the board. And I'm only going to talk to you about a couple examples of this. So one big question was, again, how does that virus get into the placenta? And to do this, we teamed up with Lenore Pereira's lab at University of California, San Francisco, and she works on another virus, CMV, that infects the placenta. So she had a lot of experience, and we worked in human placental explants to understand, with the new Nicaraguan virus that we had just isolated, how are the paths of transmission potentially. And we found that one way in is through, it's called the chorionic villus over here, where essentially the placenta invades into the uterine wall. But then we also found, just based on looking at where the virus could replicate and then also confirming that with real placenta from Zika-infected women in Nicaragua, that it actually can come through a different way, we think, which is the amniochorionic membrane. So there's kind of two routes into the placenta. We then spent some, very rapidly, again, collaborating with some of our friends, W. Corti in this case, who had some specific antibodies to Zika, that we were able to set up a new method to differentiate that antibody response to Zika and to dengue. And then we found that we were able to do this very sensitively. Around 92 to 95% would get it right, this is in fact Zika. And then also about 90% would get it right that this is not dengue. And that's called sensitivity and specificity. And so we were then able to roll that out to use it in real time, get it across the country of Nicaragua, and then also use it to understand the epidemiology, and which means what happened in our population. So this is actually 5,000 people who are from age 2 to age 80 in various of our studies, and we were able to look very quickly at what was the impact of that 1-2.5 month epidemic. And we found incredibly that 50% of the population had been infected in that incredibly short time. But it's really important to know that, because if you all you saw were the number of cases, but there's about 60 or 70% are asymptomatic. And so what this allows you to do is see, not just the cases, but if you have, say, 20% seroprevalence, you could get another epidemic because you still have 80% susceptibles. If you have 50 or 60% that are already immune, it's pretty unlikely that you're going to have that kind of an epidemic again. So we're working in real time with the Ministry of Health to let them know what's going on. And what's really interesting was the shape of this curve also. So you didn't expect to have, this linear increase in kids, because everyone should be infected the same. And when we did a whole bunch of studies with actually Fausto Busto, who's a graduate student who will speak next, we found that it's probably body size. So the body surface area was linear correlated with age, and actually it's more places that the mosquito can bite, and might actually have to do with clothing as well as more carbon dioxide that you're breathing out, which is where the mosquitoes are attracted to. So something that simple, and we actually see this with a very different virus, chikungunya, which is a different family of viruses, and we still see the same curve. So we think that very simply that might be what's going on. Okay, so how do we control this? This is work that we started many years ago and is really being led by Josefina Coloma in our group. And this is a way to get people motivated that we learned from this huge random control trial we did in 80,000 people. How do you motivate people to do something because they're interested? And what it was is their own evidence that they see the larvae in their own water, and they figured out what's the life cycle of the mosquito and how can they make interventions that work for them. And doing that, we were actually able to reduce the incidence both of dengue, but also, of course, of infestation of the mosquito. And what Josefina's done, actually working with people in the social apps lab in anthropology in this building as well, is to create an app where people will get become a dengue warrior or a Zika warrior virtually by getting rid of where the mosquitoes actually breed in real life. So there's a real life action that then gives you points to become a dengue warrior in this game. And it's really, and you compete as a community. So it's like a really interesting, and so actually we did this in Mexico and Nicaragua, and now we're actually, Josefina's working in Paraguay, in Colombia, in Argentina, and a number of other places to really see how this can go, you know, as a kind of grassroots approach to studying this problem. So with that, I'll end, and I'll thank, so this, we have, this is just part of the wonderful team we have in Nicaragua, led by Dr. Angela Blanceda in the Laboratorio Nacional de Biología in the Ministry of Health, and also in our lab, in our Centro Salud, which is our health center, and our SSI, which is our nonprofit, which is based there as well. Support from the Ministry of Health, and of course, Josefina, who's been really amazing, Aubrey as well. And then this is our group here, Fausto, who's really led the charge with the spatial analysis that he'll tell you about. And then others who've done the epidemiology and also the immunology work. Our kids, our funding, and you. Thank you.